get this started. Hello, welcome to the Warm Talking Metropolitan State University of Denver's Artist, Scholar, and Designer Series, sponsored by the Department of Art and Health and Center for Digital Art. As the off-campus art center at MSU Denver, or MSU Denver, the CDA acts as a resource for students and the broader community to contemporary exhibitions of local significance and global reach, an immersive education program, and workforce development for students interested in creative fields. Sign up for the CDA newsletter online to learn more about upcoming programming events. Excuse me. So thank you for coming out to the CDA tonight. It's an exciting time of the year in education. Our second BFA show opens tomorrow night, and graduation is imminent, just a few weeks away. And it's an interesting time of the year that often brings some sort of combination of exhaustion and exhilaration all together. So thank you for coming out to this event tonight. Before we go much further with this introduction, I'd like to take a moment to recognize the historic event about to happen in Colorado, in Denver. Tomorrow, over 10,000 teachers are marching on the state capitol. There's a tremendous increase in funding for K-12 schools. 10 of the largest districts in the state have canceled school on this historic day. If you don't already know, Colorado ranks somewhere between 36 and 46 in the nation, depending on your source, for K-12 funding. And regardless of where a state is ranked, the idea itself of some sort of national education funding ranking model reveals our problem. In Colorado, we are short roughly $2,600 per student statewide, and that amounts to a total deficit roughly of $800 million. So please bear with me as I tell you this next part of the story. But in light of all this, I have the very special privilege tonight of being the first person to make this wonderful announcement. Halliburton, one of the state's most famous corporations, one of the most powerful companies in the world, based right here in Colorado, has been so moved by the show of energy and courage of Colorado's teachers that Halliburton has decided to convert its entire asset portfolio, which amounts to somewhere around $2.6 trillion, and has been amassed through fossil fuels, military, industrial complex, and surveillance, is decided to convert their asset portfolio completely over to education. Sorry, it's just too good to choose, so I lost my train of thought here. Halliburton will divide and distribute its $2 trillion+ to students across the state of Colorado. This will result in each college student in Colorado receiving a $1.6 million scholarship. Which is why at Halliburton, your new education headquarters in Colorado, we like to say, this is one half of the scholarship. All right, it works. Raise your hand if you're familiar with the yes men, if you've heard of the yes men's work. All right. Raise your hand if you think they're funny. Okay. Raise your hand if you think they're smart. Okay, a few of you can raise your hand. Our guest Andy is sitting right here. So we're gonna ask that one more time. Raise your hand if you think they're smart. All right. Okay. Raise your hand if you think that what they do is art. Excellent. Some of you have had me in class, you guys know by now that this is a rhetorical question. The answer is art has no boundaries. It's just a question to analyze something critically. Anyways, to finish up this introduction, in the Department of Art at MSU Denver, the faculty consistently ask our students to do a few things in the pursuit of open education. You can see these keywords in the course descriptions, you can see it in learning objectives, you can see it on our website. Our department website. We ask the students explore, excuse me, we ask that they investigate, we ask that they think critically, and we ask that they learn. Tonight's guest, Andy of the Yes Men, does all those things in his incredible work. So, with Without further hesitation, if you're ready to explore, investigate, think critically, and learn, please join me in welcoming Andrew Kamal.
And we've never gotten a perfectly straight answer from a lawyer. There is no case study, which is why when we were sued, we were all pretty excited about that. Because we think we would have won, our lawyers thought we would win. Obviously our opponents didn't, but the smart people in the room thought that we would win, and that would have set a precedent saying you can do this now. But there hasn't been a lawsuit again, you know, that there hasn't been a case on this sort of thing. Probably because corporations are too smart anymore to actually try and sue activists with any media clout at all. Like, there was a case in the 90s where some activists were passing out pamphlets in front of McDonald's in London, and they were doing this repeatedly, trying to draw attention to their labor practices, to the bad quality of their food, and McDonald's turned around and sued them. And the case dragged on for 10 years, tremendous amount of media attention, and the activists won, and you know, but after there was this massive attention for everything the activists were trying to say. So it's actually the reason McDonald's has salads on the menu, and who cares, but it's also the reason that large corporations don't sue activists with any ability to draw attention.
What were a few projects that you did before a bunch of your bigger things went viral or got published?
Let's see.
Like, what led up to the initial big things that got on air? Like, you had to have worked up the courage to, like, pull off something big. So what was something like Little Medium right before?
Yeah. Well, let's see. Okay, the very first thing, this did not actually get a whole lot of attention compared to later things. This was in 1999 when this is actually how the movement started. We heard that 30,000 activists were headed to Seattle, that was the projected crowd size, to shut down the World Trade Organization, which represented everything that was bad about capitalism at the time in the popular imagination. And it was the focus of this movement, the anti-globalization movement at the time, which actually successfully shut down that meeting in 1999 and really limited their scope and really put a big dent in their power. And we knew it was important. It was the focus. It was the focus of the activist world. And so we set up a fake World Trade Organization website. And this was in 1999, so people were super used to fake websites. Like, all you had to do was that, and people would pay attention. Especially if the target of your satire reacted, which they did. They wrote this press release and put it on their website and attacked us and said, you guys are bad. And nobody actually read it, so they actually wrote us an email and said, look what you made us do. This was also apparently before the era of modern public relations. And so we actually sent out a big press release with their press release. Got a lot of press for it. And that is basically how we got started, because it's the WTO itself that started us. Because when the attention hit the web of 1999, the search engines of the time, and this is on November 30th, which I think is the date of the Seattle protests. Mm-hmm. I think that's when the day they shut them down. Just noticed that. But when search engines of the time, like Yahoo and Alta Vista, Hotbot, and whatever read text, they would kind of link them. So WTO and GATT.org and WTO.org confused the search engines, and we started getting email intended for the WTO, like this. And this went on for a long time. And the replies capitalism or neoliberalism, as it was then called, is that you let the wealthy do whatever they want and things turn out great for everyone. And you even help the wealthy to do what they want, and that's even better. So so that's how we wrote these things. And then one day we got an invitation to a conference. Same thing, just somebody reading the website, fake website, thinking it's the real thing, not reading any of the satirical content on it. And we went to that conference after dwelling on this email for 3 months. We basically didn't know what to do about this. Director General Mike Moore was his name, of all things. And he was kind of large. So we actually forwarded this to Michael Moore. We didn't know what else to do. I was like, do you want this? And waited, no answer. And then, like, about 2 or 3 months later, we finally realized, let's just answer that DG Moore is not available, and let's just send a substitute. And they said, that's great. And so we flew to Salzburg, Austria. And on the way, we were doing an activist, a talk, kind of like this, in Barcelona, and we tested out various ideas for what to do when we got to Salzburg, and came up with a whole PowerPoint presentation. And this is one slide from it, where we basically did this satirical version of the WTO, where we just pushed its logic a little too far. And we talked about how any barrier to free trade is a problem, any barrier to capitalism, any barrier to the wealthy getting as wealthy as possible is a problem, including democracy. So we had a solution to this. And this chart is actually on the slide. You might get it. It's like, this is the current version of democracy, where corporations pay immense amounts to get ads broadcast to voters with no transfer of money at the final stage. And the alternative is just pay a website to pay people to vote. And we have a website. And to our shock, we went not knowing exactly what would happen. We did ask the lawyers at the time, and we couldn't get a straight answer what would happen. So we actually just went and brought a camera person along, expecting there to be some drama and expecting something interesting would happen. And instead, people just nodded and asked polite questions again. And we didn't really have anything interesting on the camera footage besides people asking nice questions and me saying really offensive things. We went to lunch with them afterwards. I praised Hitler's economic policy. No reaction. We had this stage of pieing. This was at a time when pieing was popular. People would throw pies in the face of people they didn't like. And Milton Friedman had just gotten pie as a grandfather of neoliberalism. And Bill Gates later got pie. And so he pied me. Staged a pie, so threw a pie in my face. And then, I don't know why we did that. We didn't have to, because we did that just for fun. And we used it in the video we made afterwards. But we sent the cameraman, he had a big beard, so we shaved his beard off, and sent him back into the conference to ask the attendees if they had noticed anything weird during the day's presentation. And he found people who had been at this conference and asked them, was there anything strange about his presentation? Because he's been pied. And, he's like in the hospital because he's pied. People were also overreacting to pieing, so we played on that. People said, oh no, he's been pied, that's terrible. No, he didn't say anything abnormal. And one person even remembered exactly what I had said and said, yeah, it was about making markets more efficient in a democratic world. and stuff like that. So, you know, he filmed all that as a new, pretending to be a newspaper, a newsman, video camera. And we made a video of it. So that, yeah, to answer your question, that's what happened with that. But that was the first thing we did. It was sort of successful. I mean, the New York Times reprinted a very lengthy correspondence we had with the conference afterwards, where we actually emailed everybody at the conference after we got back to the US, and we said, look, the speaker at your conference was Pi, and he, unfortunately, the Pi was old, and he's contracted a toxic bacillus infection. And he's in hospital, and, you know, does anybody remember? Because this is a crime now, and so we need to be safe. Nobody responded, basically. And so we did what we had to do. We sent out another email and announced that the unfortunate speaker had passed away.
Oh my God.
and at this point, people started remembering things. Telling us, okay, yeah, he said this, and he said that, and they actually remembered. But they didn't see anything offensive about it. And then finally, the conference wrote to us and said, please stop. They were CC not to do that. And the New York Times reprinted a full page of that. It was pretty funny to see all those exchanges. But you know, that wasn't like giant profile. In fact, we were very shortly afterwards invited to another conference. And we thought the New York Times, yeah, sure, now everybody knows, and that was that. And nobody's going to make that mistake again. But it kept happening.
How do you start to brainstorm what to do next after that? Because like you have that little bit of rush of exhilaration. Yeah. It's like, okay, we have some power here.
Yeah.
Like, how do we use it? Like, how do you go about deciding what to do? Or is it a little bit of chance?
It's all chance. Yeah. Like, that was all chance. Like, you know, that story. And before that was all chance, too. How we got to that one was all chance. And then the next thing that happened was we were invited to a conference in Finland, a textiles conference. Just a university in Tampere, Finland, was having a big textiles conference and invited us to give a speech there. That's basically what decided what we did next and how we get the next rush. Because there is a big element of adrenaline and addiction to the fun of it. So I'll show you what happened at that conference. We decided to kind of like, to make it more dramatic so that there had to be a reaction. We just figured, okay, we'll just push it much, much further and we'll definitely get a reaction by making it so crazy that people can't just sit there. This is what we did. This was in the context of, so it's a textile conference. I'm from the WATO, we're both from the WATO, and we're talking about textiles of the future, and what we as the World Trade Organization imagine as the textiles of the future, given that we need free trade, we need corporations to be able to do whatever they want, wherever they want, overcome all impediments to working wherever they want, however they want, whatever countries they want, whatever legal issues avoided, however they want. This is the textile solution to this problem of like democracy and to, you know, it's the ultimate power tool, let's say. It's the ultimate power tool for corporate power. Yeah.
In a world where the headquarters of a company might be in New York, Hong Kong, or Espoo, Finland, and the workers are in Gabon, Rangoon, or Estonia, how does a manager maintain proper rapport with the workers? And how does he or she ensure from a distance that workers perform their work in an ethical fashion? I'm about to show you an actual prototype of the WTO solution to two major management problems of today. Now, we all know that not even the best workplace design can help even the most astute manager keep track of workers. What you need is a solution that enables complete rapport with workers, especially when they're located far away. Mike, would you help me a moment? Thank you. This is much better, much more comfortable. This is the WTO's answer to two of the major management problems, and we're calling it the management leisure suit. It's the two problems again: how to maintain close rapport with distant workers, and how to remain comfortable and increase leisure activities. How does the management leisure suit work, besides being extremely comfortable, as I can guarantee you? Well, allow me to describe the suit's core features.
Whatever it is about it in terms of the art world. Like, the art world York, I mean, it's just patently obvious it's horrible. You know, it's like a horrible system that's really not about art at all. It's about some refined thing that, you know, ultimately is about money and speculation on the value of the art, and at best it's about putting something nice in a rich person's home. But it's not really about changing the world. It can't be in that context. And there have been many times when art has changed the world. Like earlier we were talking about Grand Fury, the art battalion of ACT UP. In the 80s and 90s, artists who had gallery careers, who became incredibly important in the fight against AIDS, and the fight to force pharmaceutical companies to, they became the core of it in a sense. I mean, they became the visual core of it, like the visual identity backed up silence equals death and all these famous images that we know that was them. And that's art, you know, they were artists. They just weren't using it in the context of the art world. And they were very conscious of that, like, we don't care what the art world thinks of this, we're using it to make a difference in the world. And so, you know, we're not faced with the same degree of a state of emergency, or we weren't faced with the same degree of a state of emergency as Grand Fury in the days of AIDS, where AIDS was killing tens of thousands of people. But you know, we use the same, I guess, you know, we use whatever art techniques we have for social issues.
Would you say that you feel akin at all to like Furman Supreme?
To
Furman Supreme?
Oh yeah, he's fun. This guy wears the hat, the incident boot on his head, and runs for president. Yeah, I mean that's pretty overt satire, I guess. Like ponies, there's something about ponies. What? Oh, well, yeah, but does anybody really believe that he's running for president? Yeah?
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, it's the same general world. Yes. And there's many different flavors of it. There's a lot of different. I wanted to show a couple of, Actopedia. So that's a website that has dozens and actually hundreds of examples of creative activism. Oops. Sorted by all kinds of things, issues, regions, and you can just browse and search on things there. And Beautiful Trouble, which is a kind of more systematic, systematic overview of the kinds of work that we do, or Urban Supreme does, or many, many other kinds of activists or artists. These are, you know, various tactics that people use. Stuff about Optimor, who overthrew Molossus.
honorary, which you're going to get for tonight, which will, you know, suffice you for the next couple of years. Do you have speaker's fees or honorariums which you present to them at this, for these conferences?
For the fake appearances, no. Not just because that would be fraud.
Yeah.
It might be fraud. It's hard to tell. I mean, probably.
It's kind of a joke. That was my.
Yeah, but
it wasn't a serious question.
It was too. I'm answering seriously. No, but we don't. We have jobs. Yeah, 15, and we make movies, and those bring a little money sometimes. But mostly it's the day jobs, teaching in universities. I don't right now, but I have in the past.
That really goes into kind of my question. Can you just expand that a little bit more? So, you know, like how you balance your whole creative activist practice, maybe like 10% of your time is interventions, or maybe it's 60% interventions, and then, you know, how much do you teach, lecture, travel, kind of how do you balance it?
Now I teach zero because I don't have a job. In the past, it changes all the time. Before the election, I had a job and I did a lot of workshops at the job. So that was mixed in with the interventions. So maybe, you know, it was all kind of a lot of intervention and teaching and workshops. And speaking engagements around were, you know, maybe, I don't know, 10, 20% of it then. What else? Movies. Now it's really shifted. Like after the election, we just stopped doing this kind of work at all, except with a couple of exceptions to just see if we figure out how to fit in, how to make this work now. And I haven't been teaching. We have done some workshops and speaking engagements. We've started a movie project. We're waiting for funding. I'm making a separate movie with a friend that's not a Yes Men movie and that we're already kind of working on. It changes from moment to moment. But yeah, I really shifted with the election. That was just like, how's this work? Yeah, that's a big question.
So, if this is not the kind of work you're doing now, like, what are you working on?
Let me show you. this is a piece I did with a group in New York. It's very New York. It doesn't really make any sense here, but it does answer the question. and I really like the video. And it does address a bigger issue that I'll use the video to talk about. I did this with a group started by a couple friends in New York, filmmakers, called Creative Resistance. And it was after the election, they just were like, one of them is a super extrovert and loves talking to people and also loves to feel useful, like we all do. So they started this group of filmmakers, and there's maybe 20, 30, 40 people in it who are filmmakers, graphic designers, writers, and so on. And the goal is basically to support campaigns that matter, to resist Trump and to resist what's happening in the country. So it's about local issues. It's not about trying to get rid of him. It's about trying to support candidates at the local levels or national levels, but you know, generally local. And we've supported a few, maybe one in Montana, some other places. And we made this video in New York. I'm credited as the director, but it was super collaborative and there were like at least 10 people involved in it. So the story explains itself.
Hi, I'm Edie Falco. Election, New York State acted fast to pass.
Let me start that first sentence. Is really Edie Falco is an actor.
Hi, I'm Edie Falco. After the 2016 election, New York State acted fast to pass these measures to resist Trump's agenda. universal single-payer health care, fully funded public schools, strong environmental safeguards, and sanctuary state legislation to protect all immigrants. Just kidding. That didn't happen. But it could have, and it probably would have, if not for the Independent Democratic Conference. New Yorkers routinely vote Democrat at both state and national levels, and there is currently a majority of Democrats in the state Senate. But since 2011, a small group of so-called Democratic senators called the Independent Democratic Conference have refused to caucus with the Democrats, handing control of the Senate to Republicans. They do this in exchange for what they call lulus, bigger salaries, nicer offices, and committee chairmanships. In fact, some IDC members are literally getting paid by the Republican Senate leadership in legally questionable ways that are making headlines in both local and national press. IDC members also get tons of campaign money from real estate, charter school, and healthcare lobbyists, some of whom are Republicans with connections to Trump. IDC members say that they're getting things done, but because they hand Senate control to Republicans, hardly any progressive legislation comes up for a vote, and when it does, it is heavily watered down, like the 2013 minimum wage law. Remember all those awesome things from the beginning? They have all passed the Assembly in the last 2 years, but thanks to the IDC, they were all blocked by the Senate. IDC members insist that the fault really lies with another rogue Democrat who votes with Republicans. The truth is they are both at fault, and they use each other as scapegoats to shift blame for their treason against the people who voted for them. Are you pissed off yet? Great, let's fight back. If we can raise enough awareness in these 8 IDC districts, we can vote the fake Dems out, making New York a real blue state, like California, and inspiring other states of the union to resist Trump too. So share this video widely. Find out if your state senator is in the IDC, and join one of these groups to help us fight back.
So, and that's the organization. So, you know, it's about like making New Yorkers angry and competitive with California. And why aren't we doing that? And it, you know, it actually makes a difference. Like this video, we tweeted it for a while and got maybe 50, 100,000 views, which is bad for something so local and wonky. Then the current challenger to the governor, Cynthia Nixon, who's another famous actor, tweeted it and got immediately in the first day 500,000 views. And she's campaigning on abolishing the IDC, and we've also made some little videos against IDC members. And the other day, maybe a week or two ago, the government bad guy met with the head of the IDC and the head of the real Democrats and got them to agree to join and dissolve the IDC. So officially the IDC doesn't exist anymore, and I think it's in part because of this video and a little bit. And it's because, you know, Cynthia Nixon was able to use it to politicize and raise a stink about it. It's temporary, you know, it's obviously for political expediency that Cuomo, the governor, abolished it, or got it abolished, but this kind of work does seem to, you know, it's concrete. It's like, this will work, this does something. It's not as funny, it's not as, you know, fun to do, it doesn't give you the same adrenaline rush, but it is super fun. And it's effective, which is most of the fun. You know, most of the feeling of fun comes from it, the belief that it actually means something, and it's going to do something, it's going to change something. So for that reason, this is fun. And the stuff we were doing, and that we're going to be doing again as soon as we can figure out how, and we have one project idea that I think is really good, that we're going to be doing, I hope, in about a year. Around the midterms. That sort of work is really has been mainly about raising attention for things that are underrepresented in mainstream media, for like giving journalists an excuse to cover important issues that they wouldn't have an excuse to cover otherwise. Like, what did I show earlier? I forget. Yeah, most of our, oh right, the like the WTO things that we did. I'll show some other things that are more relevant, I think, to what I'm saying. They're like jokes, as if we were clowns. They're jokes for the media to use to cover the joke, to cover the hoax, and then they cover the important thing. But now that's not really necessary. Journalists are actually like, all you have to do is look at stuff and it's right there. There's not that much that needs to be exposed. So what is needed is mobilization, is getting people out to do things. And that our work used to do also, and will do again, in November, I think. But people are pretty mobilized. So the thing that I think feels necessary now is to get progressives elected. And that's it. The midterms, that's it. That's all I can see that's important on the national scale, at least. On the, yeah.
Have you found that like the PR firms and you know, for the hosts and stuff, they're much more savvy to what you guys are doing and kind of no change in that. They aren't picking up. No, okay.
No, I mean, some things don't work anymore. Like fake websites don't work. You know, in 1999 it worked great because the web was 5 years old. So you could make a fake website and people would believe it. And plus, it would be news, just the fact of making a fake website. Obviously that doesn't work. Search engines are much more sophisticated. Email doesn't work nearly as well. You know, we could blast out a press release, say we're the WTO, and people would get it in their inbox and go, oh my god, WTO. Now that doesn't work. For many reasons. And and also, you know, fake news is reprehensible now, so I mean, this, what we do isn't fake news, it's like we reveal it always, but still. There are other ways though of doing what we do, and we've used social media in the past to good effect. We did that for a while. We've gotten invited to conferences without ever putting up a website or using email, just by like emailing the conference and saying, can we speak? Can our eminent person from Halliburton speak at your conference, please? And doing a little social engineering, maybe a phone call or two, pretending to have some inter-office argument. And then they say, yes, please come. And especially since we pay our own way, they're just delighted. And then we do our thing. And that still works. There's no barrier to that. That's always going to work.
So have you ever been invited somewhere and had your material reviewed beforehand? Does that happen?
It's reviewed. I mean, sometimes, you know, you can go to a conference, like find, you know, search on corporate conferences and click on a conference that looks interesting or relevant, and find the speaking opportunities form and fill out the form. And they usually ask you to submit your talk in advance. So you just go to the web and find the talk, you alter a few words, and you send it to them. And they review it. That's what it is. Yeah, we can do that anytime. You can do that anytime.
Yeah. I was gonna ask if you ever got like what kind of following is that website they made, the Aardvark one, where the idea of like bids for kind of these creative projects for change. Do you ever get people approaching you now saying, hey, there's this company in particular, or there's this idea in particular that we really want to take down? Do you have people approaching you in that sense, like saying, will you do this for us?
Yeah, all the time.
Do you accept those, or is it going to take the job?
Yeah, we show them websites. We send them here. Okay. We say, go look at this, and here's another website for you. Look at that one. Not that one. That one. No. Beautiful Trouble. The one I showed earlier. I don't know where it is now. Yeah, we just give them instructions. Oh, we also have a little in-process instruction. Yeah, here it is, cookbook. Here's how to do it. Do things. We just send them the instructions and tell them to do it. Because it's not rocket science. It's like, we're just, this is, you know, we've done this for 20 years, so some things we're good at, we still screw up in major ways. And but, you know, we're not by any means the first to do this. There have been, you know, this goes way recently, the 60s, the hippies, you know, did all kinds of things of this sort. On that other website, Beautiful Trouble, it's just such a good resource. There's a history section with like all kinds of examples. I think it's under, these are principles. This is principles that you might want to think about and disagree with. Some of them contradict each other, but they're like to give you the idea of like how to think through what to do and how to do it. Action logic, that's the most useful thing in this entire book, is the concept of action logic. Like coming up with actions that convey by themselves what you're trying to say. Something artists are really good at. And then case studies. So these are actions. Most of them are pretty modern, but some of them are ancient. And then practitioners, that's the thing. So some of these are recent, but then it goes back like to Grand Fury, the artist battalion of eight ACT UP that I was talking about. And Lockport, who overthrew Milosevic in Serbia in 2000, using a lot of creative artistic techniques. It's a fascinating story. What was the question?
I just asked if you had people approach you like Art Mark was real.
Oh yeah.
Your original website about
we just say like look at what's been done, get inspired by what's been done. Do it yourself, yeah. Either do what we do if you really want, or do what other people used to do, rip it off, or come up with your own new amalgam of different things. It's all like public domain. Nobody's gonna sue anybody for copying the thing.
So kind of to bounce off of this, how do you decide your approach onto like getting messages through or like getting things done and stuff? How do you decide that the approach that you take is the approach that you take, I guess?
Oh yeah. I'll show you an example. This is an example of a so-called decision that we made. So this was a project that we undertook in 2012 maybe. There was a policy in New York, in the New York Police Department, called Stop and Frisk. You guys are not heard of this, yeah. 600,000 people a year would be stopped and frisked for no reason by the police, and it was their policy. And they would do it in certain neighborhoods, like the Bronx and places with a lot of people of color. They didn't do it on Wall Street. but they did it in the Bronx, and they, would catch people with, 5% of the people that catch or something, and I can guarantee you on Wall Street it would have caught 20%. But there was a big hue and cry calling this racist policing, and there was a big movement to get it abolished. In fact, our current mayor ran on the platform of abolishing it later. That was after this. And so these activists approached us, and one activist, basically, with a small organization, and she came and asked to do a brainstorm with us, and so we organized some students, we got some local activists, some Occupy people with some experience, and we just sat in a room and brainstormed. And we looked at all the symbols that accompany this. There's race, there's police, what else happens in the neighborhoods where there is stop and frisk, where all these people are stop and frisk. What else is there? There's food deserts, there's really bad food up there. There's all kinds of, and some good food too, but a lot of fast food. And we just looked at all those things, put them on the board, tried to think of, okay, well, how can we combine all this? What sort of headline might we imagine coming from something? And just did our brainstorming techniques. And a bunch of people threw out ideas. And then somebody came up with an idea that made everyone laugh, kind of uncomfortably, but laugh. And so that was it. And that was the bottom line. That seemed like a good idea. And the organizer didn't like it. And she said, no, we can't do that. That's really too uncomfortable. And so I just asked her to go back to her constituency, the people she was representing up in the Bronx, and talk to them and see what they thought of this idea. And so she went there and talked to her collaborators, and they loved it. They didn't find it at all offensive. And this is the result. So that's how we came up with this. It was just by, you know, throwing spaghetti at the wall and seeing what was funny.
Well, it seemed like a joke from the start. If you are stopped and frisked 3 times by the NYPD, you get a free Happy Meal. The ad on the website, where it came from, spread quickly online and had some believing it was true. Eyewitness News reporter Kristen Thorne shows us what happened and who was behind it. That's why we're excited to introduce our new 3 strikes, you're in. While the NYPD can't stop using stop and frisk, McDonald's can help police reward law-abiding citizens.
McDonald's and the NYPD teaming up to get guns and drugs off the streets seems strange. Well, it should. It's part of a spoof website called 3strikesyourein.org.
Every time you are stopped, frisked, and released, simply fill out your name, ethnicity, date, and stop, and you offer some background. After 3 stops, you're in. Bring your completed voucher to your nearest McDonald's and exchange it for a free Happy Meal.
People talk about broken window policing, but we'd like them to think about issues like what happens in a young person's mind when they know that when they leave the house, they're targeted.
Jerry Garalda and Yvonne Durant created the site. They're with a local activist group called People Enraged by Racial Policing. The NYPD stops and frisks some 600,000 people every year. Critics say it encourages racial profiling. The department says it's a vital way to reduce violent crime.
We wanted to make the connection between race and bias-based policing.
What's disturbing is their satire could actually be taken as real. Garalnik and Durant put it to the test, sending one of their own into a local McDonald's with one of the fake vouchers. The manager looks at the voucher, ponders it for a second, and then puts in the order. We reached out to the NYPD about all this, but they didn't get back to us. A spokeswoman for McDonald's says she's glad we realized this entire thing is just made up. As for the site, 3 strikes you're in, it was taken down within hours of being posted because of a copyright infringement. In Sunnyside, Queens, Kristen Thorne, Channel 7, Eyewitness News.
There doesn't seem to be a limit. It's more like, you know, doing really, really stupid things. Like, there's one I'm now looking for. It's about burning puppies. this is so embarrassing. Did I just remove it? Oh, fire brigade, that's it. Oh, God. Okay, so this was... This is what happens when you have too much opportunity. When somebody, like, this, in this case, it was that really funny comedian. What's his name? Oh, gosh. Russell Brand. He had a friend who, he has a show that's all about activism, and he's a friend who's a fireman, and there was this big stink in the UK because the UK was trying to raise the age of retirement for firefighters from something like 55 to 60, I don't know. And so... this is the first time I've told this story in a very long time. Years, since 2013. I don't remember what that was. Okay, let me just show the video. This is what we tried to do. And then I'm gonna... Oh, it's gone? Oh, okay. All right. Let's pray for the best. So these firefighters were opposing the raising of the age of retirement from 55 to 60. And so we thought of a really stupid way to demonstrate what was wrong with that. We created a public announcement of a so-called public announcement of a demonstration by old firefighters, supposedly by the government, showing that 60-year-old firefighters could fight fires really well, and that there was no problem raising the age of retirement for firefighters. And so we tried to get, I don't know if we actually tried to get public there, or we just got a bunch of friends to go. I think it was friends to go because, yeah. No, definitely it was friends to go because it was all staged. Right. We made these announcements, put them online so that it was credible that we had invited the public, and then had this demonstration of a bunch of firefighters fighting fire. So we had a pyrotechnics team and a fire truck and a real pyrotechnics team, and they burnt this giant thing. And then the firefighters, old, retired, came with their hoses and squirted the fire, and the pyrotechnics team, you know, made the fire go out a little bit. But then we're filming this, and then we film a dog barking, and a woman screaming, "Fido, Fido," or whatever the dog's name was, don't run there. And then the firefighter is like, "Ah!" and turns the hose and squirts the dog into the fire. and then like you see somebody saying, "Turn the camera off." It's a cell phone video, I guess. And somebody saying like, "Don't film that." And you just catch a little glimpse of a little charred thing. So we made this video. We put it on YouTube and we tweeted it out, supposedly from the person who had filmed it. And we tried to get attention. And Russell Brand retweeted it, and it just went nowhere. We thought a video of a dog accidentally being incinerated by ancient firefighters would be pretty funny here, and people would just go crazy over it. But it went absolutely nowhere. There was absolutely no. And I think it's because people really don't want to see a dog being hurt. Who knew? Yeah, or you have this.
So, and I came late, so you may have already said this. Apologies. So, is there, or where is the sweet spot between what I call SDA, some didactic art, that pushes information out at people, and really wonderful work, that invites people in, but still gets them, inspires them to act?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's, well... We get very didactic at the end. We use the funny stuff to get people in, as you said, and to, you know, get the media in, and to get everybody in, and to make people laugh, and to, you know, maybe make people see things from a different perspective for a moment, if you're lucky. But basically, it's about the issue. So at the end, we say, this is what this is about, and we have to we try to get people avenues for action following the things that we do. And that's why we work with organizations nowadays, with some exceptions. We work with intelligent activist organizations that have campaigns around things that large ones. They were intelligent, but we were not. sometimes we fail even when we work with organizations, but at the end, we really want to say something very simple, like stop Arctic drilling, impeach Trump, whatever it is. It's very simple and straightforward. We just, I don't know if that answers your question.
No, that's good.
Yeah? When a student interns with us, it depends on the moment. If we're doing a project, then they just become a participant in the project. We've had students who have become really important parts of projects and made them happen, basically, with us, and then gone on to do their own stuff sometimes. They just do whatever they know how to do, you know? Like, did this... this is the one thing that we've done, let's see, DNC. This we did, it was the one thing we tried to do since the election. We were invited to a conference called Politicon in LA, which is like a Comic-Con for politics. Like, people love politics, just for the sake of it. They get these, like, you know, and culture people, and they also get like super progressive people, and they just argue. And it's so not fun. But they keep inviting us, and that's great. And give us money. And so each time we try to think of something to do, and here we posed as representative, I posed as a high-end representative of the DNC, Democratic National Committee, and said that, you know, we had finally learned from our mistakes and we were now going to adopt a progressive agenda, a truly progressive one, and here's why it will work, and here's the polls that show that this is what we need to do, and here's the election results in local elections that show that this is what we need to do. And it happened to land a week after Chuck Schumer unveiled what he called a progressive populist agenda, which was not. And so basically I said, like, nobody thought this was any good, but you didn't read the fine print. There's all this stuff about universal basic income and universal health care and all these truly progressive things that people actually want and that have been proven to resonate even with Republican voters who voted for Trump. And it's all true. And it was about getting that information out there, like trying to embarrass the DNC over being such milquetoast, middle-of-the-road Democrats at a time when populism is clearly called for left populism, which has that, like, populism doesn't have name, but it can be just, you know, progressive like agitation and like really trying to get a better world rather than just following the financial breadcrumbs, which they do. So we did that, and a student, an intern, did all the social media and a lot of the camera work, and there were actually two of them, and it worked great. They got it out there. So yeah, just when we don't have a project, it can look like data entry. So I don't recommend volunteering when we don't have a project.
I guess I'm curious, you've mentioned that you can get permission to go to speaking events, maybe not conferences, but for projects such as having a full hybrid technics team, where do you
No, that was Russell Brennan.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, we did it with him. His show, it wasn't him personally, it was his TV show, Hired the Pyrotechnics Team and the Fire Truck.
Wow.
And all the fire equipment. Yeah. But yeah, we work with organizations that fund things when there's a need to fund things or have the material on hand. The three strikes you're in project, that didn't cost anything to do that. You know, it was a website, it was a video, video camera borrowed from NYU, I think. There was the vouchers that weren't really printed in any quantity. And so you can do these things for almost free. But then occasionally we end up working with an organization that has things like barges and marching bands and things like that. And so we use them. And it's not always a good thing. It's like sometimes better to not have resources, actually, we found. In 2004, during that election, right? That was the second Bush election, we had this big truck because we had a big grant. And so we thought, well, what can we use this money for? And we got a truck, and it was a big Bush campaign truck, and we made it weird and weirder and weirder and weirder. And our original idea was to tail the actual Bush campaign. We couldn't figure out where they were, though. The Democrats didn't know where they were. The Bush campaign. So we couldn't actually do that, and so we just drove around trying to make videos, funny videos, and it was kind of a flop. But it's funny, and the videos are pretty funny and weird. But we found that eventually when the bus broke down, the truck thing broke down, and we trashed it at a junkyard, we were then free to actually do more interesting stuff, and we did the best stuff after that. And then finally, the best stuff was just going door to door in Florida. We flew down to Miami and went door to door in neighborhoods that needed to get out of boat efforts. And, you know, it's what's appropriate? What's the role of this in an election? Maybe there is one, but it's less clear. It's more like it's relevant for bigger issues like environmental issues or. When it's down to the wire and you have to get rid of the dictator before it becomes a full-on dictator, then you don't do this. Yeah.
As an activist group that has traveled internationally, do you find it easy to connect with activist groups from different places with such different cultures and such?
Yeah. There's one group in Germany called Hang that they actually do what we do. They took it from us, and they do a kind of better than we do, and more tied to local issues. Their website is sure a lot better. There doesn't seem to be borders to this that we found yet. Itself in November, that's great. That's the national afford to support any progressive efforts at all. And that's straightforward. That's been done for centuries. You know, we know how to support candidates and often win. And I think that's it. Yeah. I think since Mary at a time like this, I'm not sure what the role of it is. There might be one. I'm kind of personally not that interested in figuring it out. And I think this one project that we have that for November is pretty interesting, and I'm excited about that. But I'm not, like, I used to kind of feel like I should proselytize for this sort of work and say, do this, and, you know, this is really important, and can, you know, be an extra thing in the toolbox. And it can be, but maybe it can be now too, but I just don't have the answer for how. And I feel personally like I've just got to, in order to live with myself later, I have to do what I know is going to be effective now. So, because we really are, you know, a fork in the road where it can go very, very, very dark, like beyond our imagination, or very, very bright. So, and it is a great opportunity moment, as you know. So, yeah, sorry. For when things look better, you want to join and do stuff with us, then just go to our website, vasd.org, get involved and contact us.